financial information. But as you've said, we've seen, although we've seen a few, you know, increasing requests, we haven't seen a lot of people actually making the choice and transferring out. We do find that most people are very protective of their LGPS pension rights and they're not keen to jump ship at all. They do value what the LGPS does provide.
I think the other thing is that, and I'm not sure everyone realises this, is that actually the value of 25% commutation, if you exercise the full value you can, you actually can get a significant lump sum and still retain a significant pension.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure that people always realise, you know, how much you can commute up to the maximum, but while still retaining, you know, a good income going forward. And I know, again, it's only information you can provide, not advice, but I think that is a fact that isn't always recognised.
I think there's also indications in the industry that DCLG may look at changing our regulations, because other pension funds do allow people to access the whole value of the pension as cash, that they may be looking at introducing that into the LGPS regulations. But as you said, natural tax breaks could, you know, will prevent people taking that, because when they realise how much that they can commute 25% of the capital value, they will, you know, people are quite often satisfied with that, then rather go beyond that, because they all know they have to pay marginal rates of tax on the rest of it.
Another item that we're working on at the moment is a so-called breach policy in relation to the pensions regulator. Do you want to say something about that, Paul?
Yeah, obviously, after receiving our annual returns, we are in the process of looking at our data policy, engaging with employers to try and resolve our queries. And in line with that, we're going to be drawing up a breach policy, because, as we know from April, TPR have got oversight over the LGPS. So we're drawing up this breach policy. But we need to determine what it is that the TPR have oversight over. It's my understanding that although the TPR have remit over pension law and not trustee law, the specific regulations that is determined as pensions law, like the 93 Pensions Act, the 95 Pensions Act, certain elements of the 2013 Act, the 95 Act, and any pieces of legislation that are enacted under that. But surprisingly enough, the LGPS regulations are not deemed as pension law, they're deemed as trustee law. So I'll be drawing an internal breaches policy where the fund is failing to meet requirements under the LGPS regulations, so that the fund can improve in them particular areas, and also what it is that we have to report to TPR as a material breach, and we'll drawing the policy up to determine who determines which of this material breach. Is it pension committee? Is it pension board? So that's at the moment, so I'm just thinking about how we do that.
Any other comments on this? So no. Next time we'll receive something on pensions. Could we also, Peter, as a standing item in the future, bring the updates on the LGPS here? Either the one that goes to the pensions committee, or if there's a big gap, perhaps some sort of amalgamation. I think that'd be very useful, because that was extremely informative, that first item. So that could be a standing item. I think that'd be excellent.
Certainly, it's a standing item on the pensions committee agenda, so we can certainly make it a standing item on the pension board.
Yeah.
And as pension board meetings are slightly less frequent, we'll combine previous LGPS updates. And I think the last thing to say was, obviously, the training evaluation is due in March next year. At the training event we had a couple of weeks ago, we did get the actuary to come and just say something about actuarial evaluations. Continue to work towards that, and we'll keep the board informed of progress. Thank you, Chair.
Are you content to approve the recommendations and have the report on page 90?
Very good.
Training programme, page 93,
Peter Gay. Yes, thank you. I brought an updated report. Firstly, just to remind members of the need for them to complete their induction training, in particular the online training course provided by the pensions regulator, the so-called trustee toolkit. I know members are providing information to Emma on their progress, so if you can continue to do that, and if there are any issues, then please speak to officers and be very glad to help you in terms of accessing information that you need or the toolkit and so on and so forth. I've also, under 2.3, mentioned the fact that CIPFA has published something in relation to local pension board knowledge and skills. It's something that Donna mentioned to me. We were already aware of it. Because it's copyright, I haven't included a complete copy in the papers. That's part of why I've got it on the screen here. Don't worry, I'm not going through the whole book. But I just thought I'd use the opportunity really just to highlight that it is quite extensive, the six areas. I've included them in the appendix, but it's probably easier to see them on the screen. So it starts with pensions legislation, and it is wider than the LGPS. It includes the LGPS clearly, but it's wider pensions legislation in the UK. Pensions governance is another key area. As I say, these are set out in the appendix. And it covers the areas from the pensions regulator, the pensions advisory service, pensions ombudsman. Pensions administration. And again, awareness of the publications that we have. Pensions accounting, auditing standards. That's a much shorter section, but it's still very key. And then pension services procurement and relationship management. We are subject to public procurement requirements, and that often means us publishing tenders in the official journal of the European Union. And that's something that's important for us. We have quite large contracts that we let, and we have to make sure that's done right in the right way. And then finally, investment performance and risk management. And again, there are papers later on in this agenda which will hopefully provide some more background to members on that area. But you can see there's a great deal of information in the publication that's been issued by CIPFA. It's something that we will be reporting on an annual basis, as we do for pensions committee. So there's a similar framework in place for pensions committee. CIPRA have issued this framework for the pension board, and it seems sensible to adopt it in a similar way. But I mean, just to acknowledge, members have been making good progress in terms of your training. Well done, thanks very much. And we'll keep nudging you to make sure that that's finalised. So thank you.
Could I just thank you for organising it the 29th of September. I think that was a very useful event. I know most of us were there. I think particularly the session from the actuary was very sort of timely. And I thought the actuary, she did explain that very well. And I hope that everyone who attended went away with better understanding of that very important aspect. And I also thought the investment training we received, I've heard a lot of investment training elsewhere, but it was also, I thought, focused and useful. Could I just reiterate what Peter's put in 2.7 about the calling training? I know that a number of people have been on training events outside of the 29th of September and July event. I know that Emma is chasing you and doesn't need any help from me, but could you please return those? Because, of course, as we know, one of the issues pensions regulators are fascinated by is knowledge and understanding of pension board members. A, it's a legal requirement, and B, they've actually said they're interested in it. And so they're going to come and ask. And when they come and ask here, they will not have a problem. So if you could all just make sure you send details to them, because I know people are doing training, but unless we record it, it effectively never happened.
Thank you very much, yes. And I'm glad you made the point, it is a legal requirement. Unlike pensions committees at the moment, it's still best practice, but not actually a legal requirement.
Sure. Could I just ask, have you bought that? amenable to share it or not?
I'm sure I could buy further copies for members of the board if they'd like to have a copy.
You might be expensive to buy everyone a copy, but just somebody, because it's a PDF, isn't it? I just thought you could share it, but it's copyright or something.
Well, I'll check with SIPFA and see whether I can share it or not.
That would be great.
I thought that the meeting on the 29th we agreed that the slides be sent out to the...
Sorry, you're quite right. Thank you. Could you mind minimising that?
And we'll see
that stuff.
Thank you. Yeah. Obviously, for people that went down off the front, we'll just to keep them on top of our toes. They were very useful.
I confirm, well, I agree with you entirely, Chair, on the question of the lady from the actress. She was first class. Yeah, that's the second time I've heard on the subject, and each time I learn a bit more, and I have to say that I've listened to actuaries in the past, and it was like talking to a brick wall as far as I was concerned. Now I find that I do understand it, so I never understand it fully. Anybody who takes 7 years to qualify has got to pass on. I thought it was very, very good.
No, I'd echo that. I think, as you say, I've heard a number of actuaries. Leanne is excellent in terms of putting it in Blaine's language.
Yeah, I definitely have a lot of communications with Leanne on a daily basis, and I understand everything she says. So I've had past actuaries, and sometimes we cloud the issue, but she says it as it is, and she's really good.
Perhaps you could pass back to Leanne for comments on the board, and perhaps also to Steve Lee, because I thought that again, it's not easy coming in and trying to talk investment. In a very short time that he had as well, so if you could pass things to both of them.
Steve's done that quite a lot of times, actually, in that presentation. I've heard it 3 times, so.
You've heard perfect. Next time you've got to present it, Mike.
I could be, yeah.
Chair, I was going to make one more comment on there. You know, the National Association of Pension Funds, I don't know if everybody gets these emails in, but there's always like hot topic seminars for people. But they're always in London, and I'm thinking, now why are they in London? Because, you know, there's a whole country out there, and I get frustrated because I think, oh, I quite fancy that, that looks really interesting. Think, it's in London.
Yeah.
It's ridiculous. Like, it's 2 hours, as well as if it's a day, so we're really walking to London.
One of the frustrations of localism is that everything happens in the capital city. I was born and bred there, and I deplore it.
Yeah.
Not London as an entity. But I do, you know, I agree with you 100%.
I was actually
it really
an email
annoying.
To
I would like to go to that, I think.
Yeah.
But you can't.
I know.
You know. It doesn't just apply to pensions.
Mm.
It applies to every facet of local government, in my experience, limited though that may be. Joe's nodding furiously at me.
I was wondering whether it's either, should we email just like personal, could the funding ends that, you know, members have expressed concerns that every, you know, thing seems to be quite, you know, in London.
Yeah.
Because some of the things that look like really worth attending.
It's supposed to be a national body, is it? Yeah,
exactly.
I think increasingly, I agree wholeheartedly with that, but you do notice now it's starting to come in a little bit more. Webinars where you can just log in and see it that way.
Mm.
And especially if something's only an hour or two, you know, traipsing all the way down there just for an hour or two.
It's the cost as well.
Well, absolutely.
I mean, it costs you £1,000 to sleep on a park bench, I think.
I totally agree. I mean, last week I was stuck down in Brighton at the Retired Members Conference for Unison. Fortunately, we circulate between Southport and Brighton, so next year it's not going to be too bad. But I do agree, where you're having sort of national events, why can't they sort of dot it around different centres within the country? Why is it always going to be London? I mean, it's an arm and a leg to get there on the train for a starter.
Well, I mean,
SIPFA,
the last few years, has been in London, but they did have a policy one time. Got Manchester, Birmingham, various places. I mean, I just do not see why. You know, the fact of the matter is that, what is it, that 9 or 10 million people live in London. Well, population of the UK is, what, 60 million, isn't it, or something? Population of England is 50 million. So you've got 20% of the population in London, and 80% are not in London. But you'd think that the whole world, you know, circulated around London.
I think, Mike tries it, it's a local government issue in particular. I think when you you speak to conference organisers, they tend to think East Coast or West Coast, and therefore points come down to South, because coming across from East to West is so difficult.
It is, yeah.
And that's the difficulty. So if you have a conference in Manchester, Liverpool, or Leeds, Sheffield, it's probably just as easy to get to Manchester. I think the main issue, I think, as you quite rightly point out, is the cost, because that's the hidden cost. So you see something that's quite attractive for seemingly £200 or whatever, but you double that or treble it in terms of you're getting there, because inevitably they start at 9:30 in the morning, so you're on the first train out.
Yeah, which is like a 5 o'clock start for most people.
Yeah.
Well, I have to say to Shane, actually, I'm in Liverpool because the first time I ever came to Liverpool was when the Zipper conference was here, was about 5 or 6 years. I'd never been, and I never would have come, and that's why I'm sitting here today, because I came and it was really pleasant and really liked it. And I think the problem with provincial cities is often people don't go to them. They stay in London, they've never been to Liverpool or Birmingham or Manchester or Sheffield. And that's just places like Leeds and Newcastle.
Well, we've
often
kept.
So, I'll be content on page 94 to note the report and undertake to report all personal learning and development activities to the fund.
Could somebody please take up this matter, that the board does feel about the having all these things in,
Yes, we will. I mean, I think it's fair to say when events are organised in places like Manchester, attendance is often quite low, and organisers spend a lot of time putting things together, and actually, although there's interest from expressed around this table, the reality is when they run them, they are quite disappointed by numbers. So that's why they tend to, they often will organise one here and in London, and often they cancel the one either here or Manchester or anywhere else. But obviously it is the NAPF conference this week in Manchester, so it alternates year by year between Liverpool and Manchester, so it is one event that's a bit more local, and members have been invited to that. We have the annual employers conference. I'll open that invitation up to members of the pension board. We'll send out an invitation for that. It's a half day at Aintree race course. There's no horse racing on. It's strictly business, but it's a good, easily accessible venue, and it is well supported by the employers of the fund. You'll have an opportunity to hear an actuary again, but I'm not sure who it will be.
Yes, they are good. Employee seminars are good.
And I should have said, I've asked the chair of the pension board to do a presentation on the activities of the board, so that these employees are aware of you and your role in the governance of the fund.
From what I recollect, it's quite well attended, but not attended particularly well by elected persons. Only two of us there the last time I ran.
Well, be reminding.
Well done, Peter.
Everyone involved in the governance of the fund.
Right, we take items 6 and 7 together. I think Peter briefly introduces them because they're probably going the exempt agenda. Can you just briefly just describe what 6 and 7 relate to?
Yes, certainly. The fund has two working parties, an investment working party and a governance working party, which effectively provides a venue for committee members just to consider in more detail aspects of either investment or aspects of governance and risk. Those are held either 6 times a year for investment working parties or twice a year for governance and risk, or a minimum of 6 and a minimum of 2. As I say, matters are considered in more detail, and it's an opportunity for members to delve into things like risk registers and so on, rather than occupying committee time, which can be better spent on more higher level matters. But a number of the matters discussed do contain commercially sensitive information, which is why they're in the exempt item to the agenda.
Our members are content to approve the recommendation that we note the report on page 100 for agenda item 6 and page 104 for agenda item 7. To note further those reports. Okay, that's the end of the public business. Can I now move to the exempt business? Therefore, I'm requiring the Act to read the following to you. It's recommended that items 9 and 10, which are the exempt dependencies to the Investment Working Party and the Government Working Party, that under section 100A of the Local Government Act 1972, are probably excluded from the meeting due to consideration of the following items of business, as the Investment Working Party and the Government Working Party executives, on the grounds that they involve the large disclosure of exempt information as defined by the relevant paragraphs of Part 1 of Schedule 12A as amended to the Act. Property interest test has been applied in favours of exclusion. Do I have a second then?
I second that, Chair.
My second is, are we content?
Agreed.
Could I ask any members of the press or public to leave this point, please?